Hi everyone, it's Dr. Romney. Welcome back to this YouTube channel that takes on a whole slew of issues related to understanding narcissism and other high conflict personality styles and the difficult relationships that come from these styles as a result to help people cope, heal, and just generally understand these styles. This month is a special series, though, focusing for May, which is Mental Health Month, on the sort of the intersection of a whole major mental health issues and both narcissistic abuse and narcissism. There's a lot of overlap there. And I think people are wondering about this. So I thought, well, let's break this down day by day, going through each disorder. So maybe every disorder won't be interesting to you, though I think you'll probably get insights from all of these. But you can also see like, when a disorder comes up that may be more relevant in the world that, you know, you're occupying with family and relationships. I'm hoping that this is helpful. Today, we're going to take on bipolar disorder. Bipolar disorder, once upon a time, was called manic depressive disorder, but bipolar disorder is the correct term now, as per what we'd see in sort of the DSM and the ICD 10 and 11 and all of that. Bipolar disorder, like depression, is also a mood disorder, but it definitely looks quite different. Now, the prevalence of bipolar disorder is lower than we'd see for depression. Worldwide, the prevalence of bipolar disorder is around 48 million. And the prevalence rate is only about 0.5% to 1%. It is a much more severe mental illness. And as a result, people who are living with bipolar disorder optimally would get longer term management through medication, therapy, and longer term monitoring. So this definitely can have a more severe impact than we would see, for example, with something like a major depressive disorder, but also falls under that realm of being a mood disorder. So there are two forms of bipolar disorder, bipolar 1 and bipolar 2. Not everyone is clear on the distinction, and I don't want to make this into an abnormal psychology or psychopathology class. And for that, you might want to take longer videos out there on this. I'm going to give this in the most simple way I can. People with bipolar 1 have what we call full-blown manic episodes. And manic episodes are periods of time, which I'm going to talk about more at length, where people don't need much sleep and they're moving very quickly, talking very quickly, their ideas are racing very quickly. Sometimes when they speak, they don't make much sense. A person who's manic, it's very, very clear, and it often can be problematic, putting them at risk of engaging in high-risk behaviors or spending a lot of money or just generally behaving in a way that sometimes could even end them up getting arrested or incarcerated or requiring hospitalization. In bipolar 2, we don't see mania. We see a phenomenon called hypomania. Hypomania is definitely a lower-grade mania. And by that, I mean you see still a person who doesn't need that much sleep, who definitely feels like their thoughts are going fast, who may speak quickly, but they make sense. So you're not hearing this sort of in a manic, a full-blown manic episode, person literally may not make sense. Like we'll say, I'm going to build a rocket ship. I'm going to try to become the emperor of the world. Like things that just don't make sense. But in a hypomanic person, they definitely don't sound like as though that they're so sort of either broken off from reality or not making sense. They are making sense, but they have an incredibly high energy level, they're very goal-directed, they can become quite irritable. In that way, people who are hypomanic may actually not show significant impairments in their relationships or in their work. In fact, people might say, oh, they're a little bit more annoying and they're going through one of their jags where they work all the time, but it's not nearly as disruptive. And that's the difference. And it's important to note that because some people are like, what are the differences? Now, in bipolar 1 and bipolar 2, we see that the manic episodes or the hypomanic episodes will alternate with depressive episodes. So the person is having periods of time in one way and then periods of time with depression. One thing to remember about bipolar disorder is that it's not a person who's really up at 10 o'clock in the morning and really down at 11. That kind of rapid labile fluctuation is not a signature of bipolar disorder at all. Bipolar, mania, up, 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 you're up. So the day-to-day fluctuation, that's actually something we might see more, maybe for example, a borderline personality style or even a narcissistic personality style. But people with bipolar disorder are one way for a while, like they might be manic or hypomanic for a while, and then there'll be a slow come down over some period of time. then they'll be depressed for a while. And that's like that for a while. It doesn't fluctuate over the course of minutes, hours, or even a single day. So when we're talking about a manic episode, we're talking about people who have a period of time of at least a week, okay, of at least a week, where they have really inflated self-esteem, they're grandiose, they don't need as much sleep, they're much more talkative than they usually are, and their speech is very rapid, and their speech is very pressured, like you can't get a word in edgewise. Their ideas and their thoughts are racing. They can be very distractible. They're very, they kind of get, it's like they get something in their head, like a thing they want to do, like a goal, and they can't let it go. They're like a dog with a bone. We're doing this, and nothing is going to get them off that path, even if it's problematic or risky, like spending a lot of money on a bad investment or something. And they get involved. People who are in a manic episode are at much higher risk of getting involved with things that are very risky, like spending a lot of money shopping, or spending a lot of money on luxury items or to give away as gifts, having multiple sexual relationships or indiscreet sexual relationships, or risky or dangerous sexual encounters, or really bad business investments. Now, as I said, a hypomanic episode could be any of those things. It doesn't have to last as long. You only have 4 days. It could last longer. But it's a period where you have, again, this sort of elevated mood. All the things I talked about, but not at such an escalated level. And the person would, like some people who are manic can actually look psychotic, like they've broken from reality. You wouldn't see that in hypomania. In fact, a hypomanic person might actually look really, really, like really driven. You know, and some people say it almost feels like they're on a stimulant when they're hypomanic. It has that kind of an appearance. The big thing to remember about hypomanic episodes is many people who are hypomanic can still work. They're go, go, go to the point where other people around them are getting tired and can't keep up. But that otherwise it looks a lot like mania, just not as far and just not as extreme. When people are manic, again, their mood is elevated. They can be very grandiose. They can be very irritable, hostile, and intolerant. And those are sort of more of the emotional symptoms we see of mania. The cognitive or the thinking symptoms of mania are that we see distractibility, can't pay attention. People who are manic also don't have a lot of insight. They don't understand. They don't see. They're not aware, I guess, that their behavior is inappropriate. So they say inappropriate things. They do inappropriate things. Their speech is really quick. It's hard to understand because they're kind of jumping here, there, and everywhere. It's really poor judgment. Behaviorally, people who are manic are very disinhibited. They're very impulsive. They don't like to be criticized, and they're very intolerant of it and will get very irritated when that happens. Their energy is very almost hyperactive. And in some cases, we may actually see that there could be psychotic symptoms present, again, in mania. Physiologically, people who are manic don't need as much sleep. In fact, it's for many, many days in succession. We may only sleep 2 or 3 days, 2 to 3 hours at a time. They may be much more aroused and have more, express more of a desire or a need to have sex. And you'll often see people during a manic episode will lose weight because they often don't take time to stop and eat. They're just burning a lot of energy because they're sort of go, 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 and they're not sleeping. Now, let's talk a little bit about narcissistic abuse and bipolar disorder together. Honestly, that we're not going to see the symptoms of mania or hypomania as a rule in a person who's experiencing narcissistic abuse. In other words, those symptoms would not be related because they don't really parallel each other. However, let's say a person who does have bipolar disorder, bipolar 1 or 2, is in a narcissistically abusive relationship. Okay? What we know is that a person who's living with bipolar disorder, a big part of treatment is stress management, okay? So helping a person manage stress, because that can actually, the stress of a high conflict relationship, for example, could actually exacerbate or worsen the course of somebody's bipolar disorder. So much of the feedback that people with bipolar disorder are given is, for example, have your life be on a really good routine, have a predictable schedule, have, you know, a toolbox of ways to cope with stress. Well, there are a few stressors, honestly, more extreme than being in a narcissistically abusive relationship. So if somebody living with bipolar disorder gets into a sort of a difficult, high-conflict, narcissistic relationship, it actually could really, really impact the course of bipolar disorder for them. Another issue we see in people who are experiencing narcissistic abuse is that they're not very good at self-care. So for example, people who are experiencing narcissistic abuse will sometimes forget to take their medication or not adhere to their medication as well because they're just sort of so distracted by the chaos in their lives. Medication adherence is actually a very core issue in the management, the successful management of bipolar disorder, or adhering to going to therapy or group therapy or all those kinds of support system things one with bipolar would need. Those things can get eroded if a person's in a narcissistically abusive relationship, because traditionally people experiencing narcissistic abuse don't engage in self-care. Where it does get more interesting, though, is when we talk about the overlaps of narcissism and bipolar disorder. As I was describing the symptoms of mania, I'm sure more than a few of you were saying, that's interesting, a lot of the things she's saying, grandiosity, irritability, intolerance of criticism, impulsivity, that sounds a little bit like mania. I mean, that sounds a little bit like narcissism. And that's where it gets a little bit more compelling. There's two ways we can think about it. Number one, you can see a co-occurrence of narcissistic personality and bipolar. It happens more often than you think. So a person has both styles. So you've got a person who's regularly grandiose, okay, regularly arrogant and impulsive and can't listen to criticism and all that. That's sort of where they're at all the time. And then you put the mania on top of that, it really multiplies. But where it gets interesting is that if a person has a narcissistic personality style and they have bipolar disorder, as the person comes out of mania, okay, and is heading into more of a depressive episode, or they're well managed, so they've got medications that are helping them so they don't have the full-blown manic episodes, so those are being managed, and the depressive episodes are managed as they are, that arrogance, grandiosity, irritability, hostility, inability to tolerate criticism, all of that, that's all still remaining there. If that was all due to the bipolar disorder, it wouldn't be so constant because bipolar is like up for a while, down for a while, or with medication, that tends to smooth out. But that constancy of the arrogance and the other difficult narcissistic symptoms may speak to then that a person's got both patterns rather than just seeing more of a grandiosity when the bipolar symptoms present. So again, that's when they're co-occurring. We have both the narcissism and the bipolar present in the same person. Now the overlaps, like I said, are many. And I want to reiterate that point. Mania and narcissism have a lot of shared pieces. Inflated self-esteem, grandiosity, distractibility, risky behavior and poor judgment, irritability, volatility, hostility, intolerance of other people, intolerance of criticism, impulsivity, and hypersexuality, right? All of these things are things that we see in narcissism as well. And so it's not unusual then for some people to see a person who's especially a very, very, very grandiose narcissist and say, wow, this person, you know, seems like they might have bipolar. They seem like they're manic. And you know what? It's a very fair assertion. And if that's how you meet someone at first, which you're not going to see in someone who's narcissistic, though, is that they only sleep 2 hours a night. That you're not going to see. I might see it happen once or twice. And let's assume we don't have stimulant drugs even involved in this, because a person who's narcissistic and using stimulants can also look like they're manic because they're staying up because they're on cocaine or using amphetamines or something. But we never diagnose mania if there's drugs present. We'd have to rule that out as the cause, okay, if that makes sense. But what we'd see is with the narcissistic person would have that long list of things, the grandiosity and all the things I'm talking about, but they'll still need the sleep. And they'll kind of make sense when they speak. Other than the word salad moments, you're not going to seem that they seem psychotic. Or the things that they're saying that are grandiose are really, really, really sort of beyond the pale. So it can be sort of a matter of degree. In bipolar mania, like I said, we also see symptoms that border on psychosis. When they speak, it doesn't make sense. And they're not sleeping. That's a difference between mania and narcissism. But these conditions, especially hypomania and narcissism, can really overlap. And that can confuse a clinician who may say, "Whoa, this looks like bipolar to me." and then start medicating them as though they have bipolar disorder and miss the narcissism. In a person with bipolar disorder, during the more depressive phases of the disorder, even if they're medicated, it may make it a little better, but during those depressive phases, if there's no narcissism, we're not going to see as much of the grandiosity and stuff. But if there is, we might see more of an irritable, victimized grandiosity, but we'll still see it. That's what I mean about whether it's co-occurring or not. It's interesting because if we think that the narcissism is better explained by the bipolar disorder, then people might actually be very careful around the person who's narcissistic, assuming that all of these symptoms are due to bipolar disorder. Once again, we run the risk of sort of excusing the intense and unacceptable behavior that actually would be better explained by narcissism, and people saying, oh, they're just bipolar. At the end of the day, regardless of the etiology, emotionally or verbally abusing other people is unacceptable. That's the core assumption, but it's more likely to be excused away, even if a person has both narcissism and bipolar, to saying, that's just the mania talking. For therapists who are working with clients who are managing both bipolar and narcissistic symptoms, this becomes about managing the bipolar, making sure that's managed properly because it is a serious mental illness, and then slowly and steadily working on the narcissistic symptoms. I'll be honest with you, as a treating clinician, this is a really, really difficult combination to treat successfully. For people who may be in a relationship with somebody who has both bipolar and narcissistic symptoms, it becomes very, very important that you as a family member or a partner or anyone else become educated about bipolar disorder, supporting medication adherence and therapy adherence, but not blaming yourself. Never blaming yourself for someone else's behavior, not blaming yourself for the bouts of rage you may witness, and then also through your own therapy, figuring out how to set boundaries and find support, because you will need that. This is a very, very difficult combination to have both bipolar and narcissistic styles in the same person. There also can be frustration for the family members, partners, friends, that the idea that, oh, once we get the bipolar disorder stabilized, and remember, bipolar disorder is manageable and treatable. The person just needs to work with therapists and psychiatrists. But there's frustration that, once the bipolar is managed, then we won't have to deal with all this antagonistic stuff. That'll go too. The problem is when it's both bipolar and narcissism, even when the bipolar is treated, the narcissistic symptoms are still there, which can really be a letdown for the people around a person living with bipolar and narcissistic symptoms, because they felt like, oh, we thought the meanness was going to go away once the bipolar is treated. But if the narcissism is there, that's more likely to be the cause of the antagonistic symptoms, obviously. As with all of these videos, not meant to be completely exhaustive, and in terms of more information about bipolar disorder, its causes, the treatments, and more information about it, we have put resources and links in the video notes for you to get more information that can be useful for you or a family member. And I'm hoping that this video has illuminated what many people get confused by, that overlap of mania and narcissism. There's a lot of shared variants there. What gets more difficult is teasing that apart and looking long-term at the patterns to see how much of that is that consistent thrum of narcissism versus the overlay of the sort of some of the slow undulation of bipolar disorder. I hope this was helpful, and thank you.